Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In part one of this presentation, physicist Wal Thornhill began laying the foundations for a new theoretical understanding of our sun and all stars. Standard theory remains that stars are born due to the gravitational collapse of material in nebular clouds over vast spans of time. We're told that stars die when they inevitably exhaust their fuel, or simply explode. But for many years, countless discoveries have contradicted these fundamental concepts. In this episode, Thornhill further explores the electric universe predictions and explanations for a variety of stellar phenomena.
So let's return to the declaration of our esteemed internet lecturer that our sun was born about 5 billion years ago. There is no evidence whatsoever for this categorical statement. With the thermonuclear model discredited by the observational evidence, the complex life story of stars is exposed as fiction. Two recent reports support this judgment out of a countless number of others expressing surprise at unexpected discoveries. On March 6th, phys.org headlined a report, "Star Clusters Discovery Could Upset the Astronomical Apple Cart." It begins, "The discovery of young stars in old clusters could send scientists back to the drawing board, because models of stellar evolution are based on the assumption that stars within star clusters formed from the same material at roughly the same time. However, back to the drawing board always means embroidering the set of beliefs permanently inscribed on the board. No physicist shows the intellectual integrity to wipe the board clean of its unscientific Big Bang myth and start afresh. It's all too hard and scary." So Dr. Kenji Becky from the International Center for Radio Astronomy Research says, "The formation of these younger stars could have been fueled by gas entering the clusters from interstellar space. However, observations showed that there was no correlation between interstellar hydrogen gas and the location of the clusters we were studying. We believe the younger stars have actually been created out of the matter ejected from older stars as they die, which means we have discovered multiple generations of stars belonging to the same cluster." The words "we believe" are accurate. The discovery of multiple generations of stars is not. The notion of the age of a star is based on plotting a point on the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram where the star leaves the main sequence after the exhaustion of its main fuel. But we have shown that stars do not exhaust their fuel any more than an electric light does. Stars don't die because their fuel runs out or mysteriously explodes. The Hertzsprung-Russell diagram is simply a plot of points and not an evolutionary sequence. Stars have been observed to change swiftly and inexplicably from one location to another on the diagram. When viewed correctly as a mirror image, the diagram represents the change in color and brightness of a star as the electrical energy focused on it increases along the x-axis. Sharp discontinuities exist in experimental gas discharges between dark mode, glow mode, and arc mode. These discontinuities simply explain the sharply different appearances of faint white dwarfs, bright sun-like stars, and red, so-called dwarfs, and red giant stars. The red color is due to an extensive anode glow, and the faint white color is simply a coronal glow of a normally constituted stellar body lacking a bright arc-mode photosphere. No imaginary ultra-dense dwarf object is required. There is no need to invent an ad hoc requirement for stars to have exploded and then somehow gather their widely scattering dust gravitationally to give birth to younger stars in the cluster. Stellar explosions are often invoked to clear dust and gas from star clusters. Astronomers can't have it both ways. But critically, none of this complicated ad hocery fits the observations of filamentary star birth inside molecular clouds. The second report appeared on May 18th last year in phys.org, titled "Stellar Mystery Deepens." A Monash University-led research team made an unexpected discovery that a large group of stars are dying prematurely, challenging our accepted view of stellar evolution. Their results reveal that large numbers of helium-burning stars are dying prematurely in the M4 globular cluster. Professor Latanzio from the Max Planck Institute for Astrophysics said, "Globular clusters are some of the oldest objects in the universe. Although we have some ideas for what is going on in them, every time we look carefully, we find something unexpected. They are both fascinating and frustrating at the same time." The international team found that about half of the stars tend to skip the red giant phase, instead becoming white dwarfs millions of years ahead of schedule. Demonstrating once again what's wrong with the modern scientific method, characterized as shut up and simulate, Professor Latanzio continued, "Computer simulations do not agree with this observation. So, as well as continuing observations, new computer models will need to be generated to better understand what is taking place in the cores of these stars. But the computer models are built on missing or invalid concepts. There's nothing going on in the cores of stars. And globular clusters are not understood. So the mathematical computer simulations produce a virtual, unreal cosmos that, like the movies, can be programmed to produce anything you can imagine. And the artist's impressions we see in science reports are little more than glossy advertising material, but much more deceptive because it is falsely labelled real science. There is no real mystery here. With no nuclear fire inside, stars don't die by bloating to a red giant and collapsing to a white dwarf as their fire goes out. The life and death stories of stars are fictional. The bloated appearance of red giants is not due to internal pressure caused by hypothetical helium burning at 100 million degrees in the core of a star. It is a purely electrical effect witnessed in laboratory low-pressure gas discharge tubes. Red stars are those that satisfy their need for electrons from the surrounding plasma by expanding the surface area over which they collect electrons by growing a large plasma sheath that becomes the effective anode in space. The growth process is self-limiting because as the sheath expands, its electric field grows stronger. Electrons caught up in the field are accelerated until they become energetic enough to excite neutral particles they chance to collide with, and the huge sheath becomes a uniform red anode glow. It becomes a red giant star. The electric field driving this process will also give rise to a massive flow of positive ions away from the star, or in more conventional terms, a prodigious stellar wind. Such loss of matter is a characteristic feature of red giants. Standard stellar theory is at a loss to explain this since the star is said to be too cold to boil off a stellar wind. Arthur Eddington himself expressed his puzzlement about white dwarfs. "Strange objects, which persist in showing a type of spectrum entirely out of keeping with their luminosity, may ultimately teach us more than a host which radiates according to rule." He was right. A white dwarf appears extremely hot, white, and underluminous because it is a faint white coronal discharge. As usual, a thin plasma sheath will be formed between the plasma of the star and the plasma of space. The electric field across the plasma sheath is capable of accelerating electrons to generate ultraviolet light and X-rays when they hit atoms in the atmosphere, and the power dissipated is capable of raising the temperature of a thin plasma layer to tens of thousands of degrees. The spectral lines are broadened, sometimes to the point of disappearance, due to the coronal electric field. This gives the misleading impression that hydrogen, whose spectral lines are smeared the most, is missing in many of these stars, and that therefore they are remnants of larger stars that have conventionally lost or burned their hydrogen fuel. So, globular clusters are not some of the oldest objects in the universe. Their spherical shape of a dense collection of stars and their elliptical orbits about the galactic center hint at a quasar-style birth process from the plasmoid at the heart of the galaxy. If so, the electromagnetic environment inside the globular cluster is different to that in open clusters of stars, so we should expect an unusual distribution of white dwarfs and red giant stars. And the puzzling observation that some globular cluster stars have 100 times more iron than others could also be explained by electromagnetic sorting of elements within the globular cluster at its birth. The fact we don't understand stars in the 21st century highlights what Arthur Koestler wrote in The Sleepwalkers. "The history of cosmic theories in particular may without exaggeration be called a history of collective obsessions and controlled schizophrenia, and the manner in which some of the most important individual discoveries were arrived at reminds one more of a sleepwalker's performance than an electronic brain's. Science is still in its childhood, and we behave as infants. We give far too much credit to scientists for knowing what they are talking about.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.